Mr. Perry, if I gotta hear one more man tell the man that the woman that they pursuing actually love, that, oh, she actually love you, in another damn series, we gonna have a problem. What's good, y'all? It's your good sis, Erica Vane, coming to you right here on Erica Vane TV with another All the Queens Men video. And yes, this episode was not all about that, but that's the part to chat my you know what. If you're new here, hit that subscribe button and turn on your bell notification so you don't miss out on any of my All the Queens Men content and conversations. If you're not new here, welcome back, boo. Now, this is going to be an interesting conversation because I am literally watching the demise of All the Queens Men. And I hate that for me. I hate that for we, because this was such a promising series. Eva Marcel is still providing such a beautiful, dope, engaging performance as Madame Marilyn DeVille. However, all of the other things happening around her are quite possibly terrible. Let's talk about it. Before we jump into this video, I have to let you know that this video was created during the 2023 WGA and SAG-AFTRA strikes. Without the labor of the writers and actors currently on strike, the series being covered here wouldn't exist. Through the duration of these strikes, my company and I stand in solidarity with both unions and are refusing paid opportunities presented by struck companies such as the 8 major Hollywood studios. Content created on Erica Vane platforms are independent of any struck company and not created in promotion of said company. Articles, videos, and audio posts are created in critique of the media in support of the artists who created it. It is important that you, the audience, know that these strikes are a result of corporate greed. The writers and actors have been victimized by major studios for quite some time, and the time is now to demand fair pay and working conditions, standardized practices across streaming business models, and other terms that will ensure the pipeline for new aspiring creatives remains open and viable for years to come. At this time, neither union is calling for a boycott of any television or film content. If you would like to support either or both unions, consider donating to strike funds, walking local picket lines, and using your social media platform to amplify messages delivered daily by union members and leaders. Links to official websites and more information can be found in the description box down below. Videos explaining both strikes and continual strike news can be found on Erica Vane TV. Now let's get into it. Okay, so spoiler alert, her daddy ain't dead. Cool. We kind of knew that. We knew that this man was trying to bait her into doing this. I feel like if they were going to take out the daddy, then the concierge would be there to actually do it. Fernando is a damn fool. But that does not stop Tyler Perry from giving us a horribly done in reference to CGI and effects high speed chase, because Madam is stealing a patron's car, jumping in it, going to the nursing home, old folks home, to make sure her daddy is okay. And we get a whole little sequence of her causing homeless people to lose their damn carts, people, pedestrians almost getting hit. We stop for a second so we can have a moment of mistrust, because Blue don't trust Joey's fine dark skin ass. Hey, Joey. And then we get to the actual nursing home and he all right, he in there sleep, knocked out even. And then he also reassures Madam that, like, girl, first of all, I told you not to care about nobody, and that includes me. Get your shit together, okay? And if they do come for me, I got all of this artillery right here up under the bed. Sir, how is this comfortable? Do you roll over and, like, almost bust a cap in your own ass? I'm just trying to understand. But I see what you're doing here. The information that needed to be communicated was communicated. But also, get these guns out your bed. Because if the FBI is watching you this damn much, don't you think that this is giving very much so catchable offense, visible? What are these imprints in this man's bed? I mean, you know what? Erica, don't even go down that route, because he also out here fucking the pedophile ass nurse. So there's that. Now, I'm gonna go always to the end of the episode, because this ties to the daddy, because by the end of the damn episode, Fernando is back at Blue's house, or comes to Blue's house. They decide to meet up with him, and he got a little clicker. He come in there with a clicker, like the little people who threaten to blow the bitch up, like the bombs. He got one of those. And Madam is going to get her ass on the PJ and go to Mexico to meet with the concierge like he requested before. Or Fernando's going to take his hand off this clicker and then unfortunately, Madam's daddy head gonna roll off just like Lotus's did. First of all, is this even her damn daddy? Because we don't actually get to see his face. We hear some groaning. We see some gray hair. But also, didn't he have the artillery? Wasn't he not worried about them coming? And then all of a sudden at the end of the episode, this is what's happening. And then also Joey, you disloyal mother. But also, I don't even know if he's disloyal, because this whole standoff was just very, very interesting. Madam definitely gets her pimps together. She's not shaken, stirred, or moved like she was at the top of this episode, in the last episode, because now that her father being threatened, her father already remind her that she knows what the hell to do, and they'll be playing these goofy ass games to stop looking all worried. She got her poker face on. So she wasn't stunting Fernando. She wasn't stunting Joey turning on her and taking Tommy's gun. She decides that she's going to pull a grenade out of her damn purse, shoving it into Fernando's mouth so he can shut the hell up, as he should have done well long ago. So kudos to Madam for that. And then she's going to pull a butcher knife. Mm-hmm. A butcher knife out of her purse and chop his hand off that's holding the damn clicker. In theory, this is cool, Tyler Perry. But in execution, like, I'm just looking at the scene like, what in the animated is happening here? What are we doing? It's fine. So we chop off his hand. The guillotine has yet to go off because, you know what? He got CCTV onto Blue's TV so that we can watch the guillotine and make sure it hasn't moved yet, right? Fernando, you a fool. And enjoy the afterlife. Enjoy hell, sir. With your horrible ass talking. Let me stop. Anyway, before the episode ends, he decides now that he don't got no damn hand, that fuck this grenade. Let's spit it out and blow the whole bitch up. And that's where we leave off at. Joey jumps in the damn room. Tommy grabs Madam because Tommy is a loyal motherfucker. And while he is disrespectful sometimes, misogynistic certainly, because he will slap a hoe. He don't give a damn. As long as it's not Madam, he will slap your ass. If it's not Madam or Blue or Dom, he will put them paws on you. And that's a problem, because no, man, don't do that. However, the amount of commitment, loyalty, and discipline that Tommy displays when it comes to Marilyn DeVille, that is honorable. We need to figure out what's in this man's blood, see if we can isolate that, create a serum, and then give more Negroes that serum. Because yes, the way that Tommy goes to protect Madam when this damn grenade is about to go off, and then of course Blue's jumping that same way as well, and that's kind of where we leave off at. The way that Tommy protects Madam is unmatched. The way that Tommy puts Madam first is unmatched. This man is worried about her livelihood and her pleasure at all times. And you know what? We love to see it. I ain't even gonna hold you. You might be doing a horrible job protecting her, but goddamn it, you have the best intentions at heart, and you gonna lay your life on the line for her, and then you also gonna try to make her stop working and have a couple big O's. So how can we blame you? How can we blame you, Tommy? Now, in other news, because Madam has a high-speed damn chase all through the streets of Atlanta trying to get to her damn daddy, Tommy has to take the car and try to ditch it. But before he can do that, he actually gets caught. Detective Davis is having a parlay with Casanova's old unhoused pretending to be ass, because he's trying to get in contact and he knows that they're trying to kill him. And he got a... That whole scene with them, the fact that she arrested him, put him in the car, y'all have fishbowl ass windows. Girl, where's your tents? Because whether you talk to him on the street or you talk to him in his damn car, you still sat here. You ain't even pull off. You ain't going nowhere darker. You ain't. So if anybody was really looking for you, they could have found him. They could have seen him. They could try. Anyway, so many loose ends. Anyway, Detective Davis gets a call when Tommy gets snatched up by the little rookie cop, because Madam just had a whole goddamn high speed chase all through Atlanta, and he happens to be the one caught with the car. And Detective Davis does her big one, I suppose, and gets Tommy, comes to the scene, talks to the rookie, takes the case off his hands, and then ultimately delivers Tommy back to the club, unprocessed, unprosecuted, unreal arrested. And she like, looky here, I done already told you, I'm looking to be of service. I just want to make sure that money right. I got information, girl. If you, I mean, I guess, you know, salespeople got to sell, but like the way she talked about this information, the more she talked about it, the more I felt like it was insignificant, because girl, you're trying to sell me too hard. It's giving infomercial in the middle of the night on BET. It's giving 3 a.m. You should buy these 12 CDs for $1.99. Like, Detective Davis, not too much. And also, I guess, not enough, because she also ends up in VIP with Doc ass, pretending like she don't want it, but she definitely do. So what I'm confused with when it comes to Doc, not Doc, Detective Davis is if she's really turning on the cops. Because I ain't gonna hold y'all. After the last episode, I was like, okay, she has every reason to be like, you know what, fuck this job. I can make more money on the other side. I ain't winning. So when I join the winning team, if my real goal is to actually win, make a couple dollars so that I can actually look cute because I'm wearing these boxy ass blazers and whatever the hell this is I got on this faux leather skirt. The Detective Davis is a cute woman, a gorgeous woman, in fact, but the damn clothes they got her in is horrible. Anyway, Madam also points this out, but I digress. I last episode thought that she could be Breaking Bad and like turn it to the other side. However, in prepping for this review and then rewatching this episode, I'm like, they also told her to do what she had to do. They told her to cut corners. They told her to not play by the rules or follow the book to get this thing done. So when she has the interaction with Casanova and she's basically seems like she snapped back to who she was, I get a glimpse of like, wait a minute, the law-abiding officer is still very much so there. It seems like she's still very much so in a place of wanting to bring this case home. So all of this, fucking Doc and going to Madam about money and giving information and all of this, feels like she could be going the route of trying to entrap Madam. And the ways that she could do that is if she gets Madam to concede to buying information off of her, she could, you know, record that and that could be proof to prosecute Madam or at least start to catch up on little things. And then once she's in, she'll be able to see more things so that she'll be able to get stuff firsthand. Now, how she prevents herself from being an unreliable witness and getting caught up as well, because as she mentioned to Madam, like, there's video of you coming in here, there's video of you taking money, there's video of you going into VIP, however long you stayed in there, so that Doc could blow your back out yet again for the eighth time now. How are you gonna fight that? Because Madam's lawyers will be paid to point all of that shit out. I don't know. So I'm really lost as to if Detective Davis is really done with being a police officer and is ready to go to the dark side, or if she's just going to new lows to try to bring this case home. I guess only time will tell, right? Now, the damn Three Stooges in this episode. So damn dumb. What I will say is I really enjoy Rayshawn's energy. I think that he is funny. I think that his comedic timing is great. The actor who plays him is doing a phenomenal job playing Rayshawn, because I believe him 120%. Trouble and Champion, they take me in and out every now and again. Everything don't always land, but you know, that is what it is, right? They want Rayshawn to answer the phone for Miss Tandy because he ain't playing that. Rayshawn has no rap. No rap from Miss Tandy, and he's only going through all of this because the two people that are left in his life are really pushing him to do that. And y'all are begging like crack fiends, honestly, about this money, and it's giving y'all broke. And this is not even trying to broke shame nobody, but like, y'all giving like not cute broke. I mean, I guess there's no, how do I want to articulate this so y'all don't get mad in the comment section? Listen, I am not a millionaire my damn self, but also the begging in this regard behind some shit to have nothing to do with you, where you're putting this boy in a position to compromise himself again and to relive traumas that are unthinkable and unspeakable, but yet Trouble ass keeps speaking about it. That's nasty. That's dusty behavior. That's what I mean. So it's not necessarily the brokenness that's jumping off of y'all asses and then stinking up the room. It's the dusty desperation. That's what it is. The dusty desperation that's coming up of Champion and Trouble is a problem for me. But I digress. We still wind up at Miss Tandy house because she want him to come to the house to get the money. And of course, when he get there, she in a negligee and her off-brand ass Savage X Fenty, because it's not Savage X Fenty. You still a cute girl and all, but it's still not giving what's supposed to be gave. You still giving Predator. And yes, the one with all the shit coming out of his head. And your raggedy ass husband is in this little faux silk leopard thinking he doing something. Fake ass Hugh Hefner. You ain't doing a damn thing. Y'all are nasty. Okay? Straight nasty. When Rayshawn get in there, y'all ain't got no paperwork. You do got the money, but you shucking and jiving and think that you about to exploit this boy again. And then when he try to leave, you have y'all little man boys come out and think y'all gonna hold him back. But guess what? He packing, and he'll put a bullet in every last one of y'all hoes. What it is and what it ain't. Oh, we scared now, Miss Tandy? We got our hands up now? Oh, all right. And then he also got backup. Now, Trouble and Champion are not necessarily the best backup, because they don't just want the 125 that's in the bag. They talking about where the safe at, because we in here now, and you done crossed the line. And they not wrong. I low-key wish she would have left the bag, because Rayshawn could have beat the hell out of her husband as he did and then walked out of there with that bag, and y'all do what y'all gotta do with that damn safe. That's between y'all and Jesus, okay? You, Miss Tandy, these men boys, and Jesus, because I done did what I came to do. Rayshawn, you could definitely get off with a crime of passion, because they was gonna try to keep you up in there, and you ain't seen no jail time if you ask me. I don't see a jury that's going to convict you after all that they did to you. But what I will say is, Trouble, I appreciate you cold cocking Tandy twice, but the man, the white man, should have definitely got the butt of the Glock first. You don't go smacking on no damn black woman before you slap the shit out of the white man that's standing behind her, making her do the goofy shit that she doing. Come on now, get it together. But it's okay. He didn't get the butt of the Glock, but he got his brains bashed in because Rayshawn said, you know what? I'm done. Enjoy hell. It's all the little raggedy mofos that belong in hell getting sent there this episode for me. That's the silver lining. Okay, Erica, it ain't that damn bad. It's cool. It's cool. Now, in inconsequential news, Dom has no rap for Big D. And Big D, like, this is where I was talking about in my intro. The way that Tyler Perry has Big D respond to Amp, because Amp cannot stop being the most raggedy nigga that ever walked this earth. And he wants to jump in Big D face every chance he get. And Big D's response to Amp's disrespect and constant harassment is, that girl really loves you. Why? It was okay, Tyler, when the first and the second man did it. But now you got all of the so-called good men, because, you know, Big D, you an informant and shit. Now I got problems because you snitching. But that's a whole other conversation. I'm going to stay where I'm at right now, right? Why are the so-called good men always the ones that got to profess to the trash Negro how they are so deeply loved, Tyler? Stop it. I'm tired. You have basically taken the persona that you have given Aaron, wrapped it up and put it into Paul and Zatima, and now this is coming out in Big D and all the Queen's Men, and these are all different series, and I'm watching all different series for different stories. Don't give me the same damn storyline wrapped up in different people, different bodies. Don't do that. Don't do that. That's lazy as hell. And now I got problems. All the respect for you, Mr. Perry, but also let's call a thing a thing, and let's have a conversation as cousins, because when Big D said that, I like to take my remote and throw that straight through the screen. Like, just TV ruin. Because why does he need to say that? Even if he believes it to be true, why in that moment does he need to say that? What about Amp? Does he need to protect his ego? Does he need to boost him up? He's not his damn friend. Amp wants to end this boy. And you mean to tell me Big D has no animosity, no feelings, no real gritty response to the man that's plotting on his damn downfall? Huh? I let the shit slide when Paul said it to Zach in the recent episodes on the team, but because Zach headbutted him. Zach is volatile and Zach is disrespectful as hell. I let it slide because I believe that Paul could be that type of person, but I'm not letting it slide with Big D. I'm not doing it. Whether he a nice guy or not, I'm not doing it. Amp is way too disrespectful. He's a goddamn crackhead, for God's sake. And he's running around here completely unchecked. And I have a problem with it. You are one of the characters who could actually check him. And you are suffering by way of his harassment and disrespect. And you turn to him and say, she love you. Who gives a fuck who she loves? And that brings me over to Dom, goofy ass. Why do you love this man? Why, Dom? Because he's trash. Been trash, always gonna be trash. Point blank, period. Let that go. You about to sit here and hold a grudge with Big D for killing somebody that Madam told you that she needed killed, and you fight with every other death around this motherfucker. Amp strung that girl up like some goddamn Christmas lights and ended her. And you helped them get rid of the goddamn body, but you about to hold a grudge for Big D when Amp's crackhead ass has been wreaking havoc over your life? Make it make sense. It's giving bird behavior. And y'all know what happened when I start to feel like this is birds. I gotta disassociate. I gotta let them go. Release them. Because you won't affect me with your bird flu. You won't do it. aside from that, we get a very quick moment when Doc is taking Detective Davis up to VIP where Midnight and Babyface are talking, and they're like, what the hell's going on with that? Do you think the Doc flicked? And I think that that is given to us because, again, it's very quick, because these niggas about to try to take some things into their own hand. I think that Midnight saying let it go, if they came from Madam office, then it's fine, it's still not going to dissuade Babyface from trying to do some stuff, because his ass is just angry for to be angry. Sir, you have not been prosecuted for throwing this lady off this damn bridge. You need to be born again, be out here shaking your ass, get your money, take your ass home, and mind your business. You haven't smoked for Big D. You trying to be Sherlock Holmes and figure out what the hell Doc doing. What you gonna turn on him, try to beat his ass too, after y'all try to beat El Fuego's ass? Like, who are you loyal to, Babyface? And it's giving you will get your ass beat. That's what it's giving. The guys also have some kind of little run-in, but I kind of clocked out, because they always arguing, calling each other a bunch of bitches. And it's, you know what, the only thing I will make a note about, it's interesting how they call each other a bunch of girls, a bunch of bitches, whenever somebody is doing some behavior that they don't like. Meanwhile, y'all all answer to a woman, a bitch, if you will. You all take her orders without question. So check y'all misogyny. And with that said, that's my breakdown. Let me know what you thought about the episode in the comment section down below. I'm your good sis, you love to talk TV with. Give this video a like, because you made it all the way to the end, and I think that you liked it. If you haven't subscribed already, I don't know what you're waiting on, babes. Right there. Bop. Just go right down there right now. There we go. Click the button. See, now you in there. You ain't gonna miss nothing. See you in my next All the Queens Men video.